Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming. My name is Jim Heddle. I'm with EON, the Ecological Options Network. My partner, Mary Beth Brangan, is here and will no doubt correct any mistakes I might make. I want to start with acknowledgments. I want to acknowledge the wonderful spread of organic radiation protection food by Shahara. Please stand.
Shahara.
And put some claws. And her husband, Dietmar.
Thank you.
I also want to acknowledge our co-sponsors, the dynamic duo of Donna Sheehan and Paul Raphael, the founders of the Cultural Potholes Institute, who unfortunately, after setting this all up and helping us get it all together, have to go down south for an operation to make Donna live another 40 or 50 years. So they couldn't be here, but they send their best regards, and we love them. And if you want to send healing energy to her on Tuesday, that would be very welcome. I also want to acknowledge our board member, founding board member, Rachel Johnson. Martine here?
No, Martine couldn't make it. She's moving.
Okay, and we'll thank other people as we go along. We're going to begin with a video report on an action that took place on Hiroshima Day just a couple of days ago over at Livermore Laboratory, which, as most of you will know, is the center of evil in this region, developing new nuclear weapons, new distribution and delivery systems. And so that'll kind of set the tone that we are looking here at what we call the deadly trinity, weapons, energy, and waste. It's the Terminator trilogy.
From nuclear.
Trinity, yeah. So we're going to begin with that, and then we have a whole wonderful list of speakers, and we will introduce them as the occasion arises. So give me a moment, and I will start the bubble machine here. So thank you for your attention. The next attraction on our roadside attraction show is going to be the celebrated author Cecile Pineda, most recently the author of Devil's Tango, How I Learned to Do the Fukushima Step by Step. She is not only a terribly prolific author, but she's also been a playwright and a theater manager, and has had a very varied and rich career of creativity, which she's still indefatigably pursuing. Please come and tell us what you're going to say.
Thank you. Applause for Harvey. I don't need a microphone, do
all
I?
Right.
I don't think so. It gives me great displeasure to introduce Harvey Wasserman. I wouldn't have to be doing this if Fukushima hadn't happened on March 11th, 2011. I wouldn't have to be doing this if GE hadn't peddled the Mark I boiling water reactor worldwide, knowing that it had a huge probability of containment failure. I wouldn't have to be introducing Harvey if there were not already 400 nuclear reactors in the world, at least, and that each generates 20 metric tons of waste every year. And if there weren't already 330 metric tons worldwide with no technology in sight for sequestering it from the biosphere for 200,000 years. I wouldn't have to be introducing Harvey if nuclear energy weren't joined to nuclear war at the hip, because plants generate weapons-grade plutonium for bomb-making. Otherwise, they wouldn't be profitable. I wouldn't have to be doing this if the Pentagon, in a bow to austerity, didn't have a nuclear war on the cheap planned for Russia and possibly China in 2016. I wouldn't have to be doing this if there weren't 17,352 nuclear warheads in the U.S. arsenal right now, capable of destroying life on a total of 340 planets. Hell, I wouldn't have to be introducing Harvey Wasserman if Enrico Fermi hadn't split the atom in 1934. But I want to introduce Harvey because he has some terrific t-shirts, which I hope you'll buy, so that he won't have to schlep them all the way back home to Ohio. So here we are on August 10th, 2014, 69 years after the number one empire crossed the line in the sand and delivered the first of two atom bombs on a civilian population, although there were most likely more than just one smaller scale experiments conducted on its own people and in its own territories earlier, and many more would be scheduled later. So, let me stop here by sharing just one small ray of light with you. This quote from Howard Zinn: to be hopeful in bad times is not just foolishly romantic. It is based on the fact that human history is a history not only of cruelty, but also of compassion, sacrifice, courage, and kindness. What we choose to emphasize in this complex history will determine our lives. If we see only the worst, it destroys our capacity to do something. If we remember those times and places, and there are so many, where people have behaved magnificently, this gives us the energy to act, and at least the possibility of sending this spinning top of a world in a different direction. And if we do act, in however small a way, we don't have to wait for some grand utopian future. The future is an infinite succession of presents. And to live now as we think human beings should live, in defiance of all that is bad around us, it in itself is a marvelous victory. Harvey Wasserman has lived his life and dedicated his heart and mind to the spinning top for over 40 years. Please cheer this kind, compassionate, and courageous warrior.
It's a full house. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming to this wonderful gathering. And I want to acknowledge some of my heroes, Jim and Mary Beth from Eon, who do so much great work. The great Jerry Mander is here somewhere, who's an old buddy of mine. And Jerry actually gave me the only grant I've ever gotten in my career, which helped me write the book Solartopia, which is
Yay.
Another hero of mine, Claire Grinsfeld, is here.
Yay!
my boss at Greenpeace. Amazing. I can't. It's hard to imagine I had a boss, but. And Polly is here. Polly works with everybody's hero, Bonnie Raitt. Making it possible. And there's a musical hero here that I want to acknowledge. Rambo and Jack Elliott is here. It's an honor to have you here. But you are all my heroes because you're all activists, and to come inside on a beautiful day like today is a great sacrifice, especially to hear a geezer like me. So it's wonderful to be here. I'm honored. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with some good news, and then I'm going to go into some deeply troubling bad news that I'm going to talk about Fukushima, and we'll pass out Prozac and Zoloft for that part of the presentation, and then we'll go back to the good news. Okay. First of all, the greatest piece of good news is I have a daughter here, Shoshana. She's 15, and she's traveling with me. It's a joy and an honor to have her here. She's truly gracious and wonderful. And this is for her and for all of our kids and our grandkids. The good news is this. We are winning. There's no doubt that we are winning. Those of us who are confronted with the awesome and awful reality of defeating a gargantuan corporation like the nuclear power industry, which is joined at the hip with two other enormous industries, the coal, oil, and gas industries. Together they're coal, oil, nukes, and gas, or what I call King Kong. It's hard to watch that movie, actually. There have been three versions of King Kong, and they've gotten progressively worse. In at least the first one, King Kong comes off at the end as kind of a sympathetic character. This King Kong, the Koch brothers and their allies, nothing sympathetic about them. But in my career, I've had the good fortune. I went to my first demonstration in 1962, before all of you were born. There was a roller rink in Columbus, Ohio, where I was growing up, that was segregated, if you can imagine that, in 1962. And we went there and we picketed. And we chanted, "Don't skate, integrate." And we won. We actually forced, three of us from our high school, we actually forced them, well, not just us, but it felt that way at the age of 17. We forced them to integrate. And that was really the first taste of victory that I had. And I thought, you know, this is pretty cool. We can really change the world. And we have. Many of us in here have marched for civil rights. And, you know, someday we'll have a black president. Many of us, and we march for women's rights, and someday we'll have a female president, and beyond that, we'll have a gay president. Actually, we have had a gay president, by the way. So I teach college. Who knows who the gay president was? James Buchanan. James Buchanan was gay. He was the guy before Abraham Lincoln. He lived with the guy who was vice president before he became president. The postmaster delivered their mail as Mr. and Mrs. Buchanan.
Wow.
And Andrew Jackson, my least favorite president, referred to James Buchanan as Aunt Nancy. So we do have some proof. And you can ask me about anything you want to know about American history. Don't ask me now, or we'll be here about 3 hours. But I will answer your questions later. There will be a quiz. So having started off with a victory, many circumstances brought me to a situation where I wound up fighting nuclear power on a hippie farm in western Massachusetts. And when we started, first of all, we were given no chance whatsoever of defeating this power plant. And then in 1974, Richard Nixon, I'll talk about him in a minute, by the way. That's something I have to say about Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon said there'd be 1,000 nuclear plants in the United States by the year 2000. This was in 1974. And we were looking at this, you know, we were in our 20s, and we knew we were gonna beat the plant in our town. We were given zero chance, which is what I like. And we beat them within 4 years. They never got the bulldozers in. And the place where they were going to build it is now a nature conservancy. And you can go to this place. It's called Montague, Massachusetts. And if any of you want to go there, I'll give you directions. It's a beautiful town. And so, you know, once again, we won. And with the year 2000 has come and gone. And in the year 2000, there weren't 1,000 reactors in this country. There were 104. Today there are 100, soon there will be 99, because we know that Vermont Yankee will shut. Now in the film also you heard a woman talking about 54 reactors in Japan. That's the one good thing that has come out of Fukushima, is on March 11, 2011, there were 54 commercial reactors in Japan that were licensed to operate. Does anybody know, this is the second question on our quiz, does anybody know how many commercial reactors are operating in Japan today?
Zero.
Zero, not one. And that's because of Fukushima. That's a hell of a price to pay. And they are, the government is, and it is a fascist government now in Japan. Very, very bad, very dangerous government. They're resuming whaling, for Christ's sake. They're desperately trying to reopen these reactors, and so far we've beaten them. So there are 54 been shut there. VY will go down. And the good news around the world, around the United States, is that we have had a tipping point now. We've crossed where solar and wind and other renewable energies are now cheaper than operating reactors. And this is a big deal. I want to mention a reactor that nobody talks about, for good reason. It's up near Green Bay, Wisconsin. It's called Kewaunee, K-E-W-A-U-N-E-E. Who's heard of Kewaunee before? Okay, well, it's not the Stephen Douglas son, that's Suwannee. So Kewaunee is an old reactor. It was fully amortized, totally paid for. No major engineering problems, no steam generator trade out, none of that stuff. And they just couldn't compete. Even though their mortgage was paid, they just could not compete with renewable energy. And unfortunately, and this is another issue we can talk about, fracked gas. But nonetheless, the owners of this reactor just were losing money on it, and they couldn't find a buyer, and they just shut it down. This is the first reactor to basically fall over of its own weight. And there are many, many reactors in the United States now in this position. I'm basically from New England originally, and the Pilgrim reactor south of Boston, we hope, is going to go down. There are 23 reactors in the United States that are identical twins to the five at Fukushima of the six, the first five that went down there. And so all across the United States now, we have reactors that are going to start tipping over. And you're going to see, economically, we don't want the other kind of tip over. But we do know that what's going to happen now is the Koch brothers and their nuclear allies are going to go into state legislatures, and they're going to try and get bailouts for these reactors that have already been bailed out three or four times. And they're going to say that for global warming purposes, we have to keep these reactors open. Never think the nuclear industry doesn't have a sense of humor. I mean, the idea of they don't have, we know they don't have any shame. The idea that you have to keep a nuclear reactor open, I'm making this difficult by moving around, aren't I? We have to keep a nuclear reactor open to fight global warming is absolute insanity. Is Stuart Brand here by any chance?
Yeah.
No, he's not. Okay. I was hoping he'd be here. I do have one kind word to say for Stuart Brand. I never actually met him personally, but we were debating on the radio, and somebody attacked me, a caller attacked me, and accused me of making money by fighting nuclear power. And Stuart, whatever other faults he may have, chimed in. He said, you know, I disagree with these people, but nobody ever got rich fighting nuclear power. So thank you, Stuart Brand, for that dose of reality. Nonetheless, the money is now on our side. And I'm going to tell you why at the end of the talk. That's the Solartopia side. But the economics have shifted radically and importantly to the fact that we no longer can say that nuclear power is a cheap source. It never was too cheap to meter, but it's not even cheap enough anymore to compete with gas or with renewable energy. The cost of solar and wind has plummeted, and efficiency, of course, is way, way more cheaper than any of the other sources, and so that's where we're at now. And the danger of the situation is that these reactors, as they grow older, get more and more dangerous and more unwieldy. I call them jalopy reactors, and that's really what they are. And so, you know, these corporations don't like to put in money to sustain these things. And so the older they get, I mean, anybody in here driving an automobile that was designed in the 1960s? I guess a couple of you might be. I have a 92 Volvo, but, you know, beyond that, these are really old machines. And the longer they operate, the more dangerous they get. So let me get into the, I'm going to make a fashion statement here. Let me get into the hardcore, the depressing side of the talk, because we do have to face Fukushima and the reality of it. So we came up with this in 1973, by the way, at the end of the year in 1973. One of the world's most effective advertising slogans, I would say, along with diamonds are forever and plutonium is forever, which we were listening to in the car coming up. So Fukushima. the bad news is it's all bad news, except for those 54 reactors, and it's getting worse. I mean, what happened in Fukushima is we had an earthquake. It was a 9.0, which is as big as they say, as big as we've registered. But thank God, and knock on wood and all that stuff, it was 120 kilometers away from Fukushima. God forbid it had been 12 kilometers or 1.2 kilometers or 1.2 meters, as could happen at Diablo Canyon. And I will get to Diablo Canyon, believe me. And so we think that the meltdowns at Fukushima, followed by the explosions, but we think the meltdowns may have been caused by the earthquake. And of course, the tsunami made it worse, but we could have had three meltdowns at Fukushima without the tsunami. The nuclear industry doesn't like to hear this, because there are dozens and dozens and dozens of reactors all over the world that are more vulnerable to earthquakes than was Fukushima. I mean, with Diablo Canyon and with San Onofre, which thankfully, all of you, we shut down those two reactors not long ago. A huge victory for the anti-nuclear movement and for the human race. So Fukushima, I was actually in Japan in the 1970s and marched with the people there, and we talked about Fukushima. I wrote an article in 1977 that was published in The Progressive that included a discussion about Fukushima. Everybody told these guys, you know what I'm saying, it was a natural disaster they couldn't have predicted. Everybody told them, you know, we don't think it's a good idea to build nuclear power plants in an earthquake zone surrounded by tsunamis. I mean, tsunami is a Japanese word, and although it would apply to Diablo Canyon. There's no doubt about that. Diablo is the only one in the United States legitimately in the path of both an earthquake and tsunami, although...
San Onofre too.
Well, San Onofre was. Thankfully, we shut that one down. But I will tell you... I'll tell you that the spent fuel is there, yes. But I will tell you that there are about three dozen reactors in the United States that are downriver from dams that, if they broke, could deliver the equivalent of what happened at Fukushima. The most egregious of them is three reactors at Oconee in South Carolina, downriver from an earthen dam with a 60-foot crack in it. So, you know, this could happen. And in fact, we've already had one, Fort Calhoun, which we now call Port Calhoun, in Nebraska, was flooded. And the water came right up to the lip of the reactor. Now they're trying to reopen the thing, but we do have experience with this. So when the earthquake shook Fukushima, there was another dimension too. Fukushima is built on the coast. Of course, all reactors in Japan are on the coast. Japan is mountainous and it comes down to the sea. At Fukushima, the reactors were actually sited on what was an 85-foot bluff. It was 85 feet above sea level, which would have been well above the tsunami level. But the geniuses that built these reactors took down the bluff because they didn't want to have to pump up the water to cool the reactors. It's insane. They put these things where there had been a bluff, and the units 5 and 6 were still relatively high up. That's one of the reasons they weren't affected. But 1, 2, 3, and 4 were right smack, very, very close to sea level. And then they to top it off, they put the backup generators in the basement. And then they built the tsunami wall, well under the historic levels that we knew tsunamis had attained at Fukushima. This was in no way, shape, or form a natural disaster. This was a human disaster in every aspect of it. And even if the reactors had been high up, and this is one of the fallacies of nuclear, the pumps themselves could have been destroyed by the earthquake and tsunami, and they're always going to be at sea level. So to a certain extent, you know, it may not have mattered, but we know if you have an 85-foot bluff, you don't take it down to stick reactors at sea level. Diablo is a little higher up, but, you know, it's not at sea level, but it's still dangerously vulnerable to anything you want to imagine. So in all the years I've been fighting nuclear, which is since 1973, we never discussed multiple meltdowns. It was always a question of the China syndrome and one reactor melting down. Here we had three. It's surreal. And I got to tell you very clearly that all these decades, the nuclear industry always insisted that a commercial reactor could not explode. If someone ever got in a public meeting and said, you know, all these things are going to blow up, the industry would come at them and say, you're totally not credible, blah, blah, blah. And the anti-nuclear people said, oh, you know, cool, they can't explode. We believed that they couldn't explode. Now, there was an explosion at Three Mile Island, a small explosion, hydrogen. We don't know how small. We don't know if it was contained because of the actions of one woman. I told this story in Berkeley. I'll tell this real quick. When Unit 2 was being licensed at Three Mile Island, that's the one that had the meltdown, there was one woman whose name still escapes me in central Pennsylvania who fought like hell because the reactor dome, if you've ever flown into Harrisburg, you fly right over the nuke. And she demanded that they make that reactor dome, containment dome, strong enough to withstand a jet crash. Now, you know, they've never tested a reactor dome with a jet crash, but nonetheless, so TMI Unit 2 was probably the strongest containment dome in the United States. And it's worth repeating that we still don't know. There was a hydrogen explosion inside a Three Mile Island. We don't know if it did not rip apart the containment because it was made stronger by this one woman. So never think that you don't have an impact. This woman could have saved, one person could have saved the entire Northeast. It's absolutely credible and quite possible, actually. I'd even say likely. Then Chernobyl exploded, and they said that, well, that's a Soviet reactor. It couldn't happen to American reactors. So let's make this clear. The four reactors, units 1, 2, 3, and 4 at Fukushima, that exploded during and after the disaster of March 11th, 2011, were American reactors. General Electric American reactors, Mark 1, 23 of them here in the United States, another 8 Mark 2s, and you know, this is American technology, folks, and these reactors exploded. There is absolutely no doubt about it. We've seen the film. Not only did they explode, and not only do we have three melted reactor cores, we don't know where they are. They're in the ground somewhere. I mean, we know they're in the vicinity somewhere, but they're not. Who knows where they are? There's water flowing by, and there's 300 tons of radioactive water that's contaminated by these three reactor cores pouring into the Pacific every day. And of course, the apologists for the nuclear industry say, well, it's a small amount of radiation that can't harm human beings. Well, first of all, that's bullshit, if you'll excuse the expression, or even if you don't excuse it. And second of all, what about the ecosystem of the Pacific Ocean? What is a safe dose of radiation for algae, for phytoplankton, for starfish, for tuna, for sardines and herring? Nobody knows. They could be, at this moment, gutting the entire Pacific ecosystem. I hate to be saying that, but it's the reality of the situation. The radiation is coming to California, as it did come from Chernobyl in 1986. We have another hero, David DeSanti, who was an ornithologist at Point Reyes Station near here. You studied the birds for 10 years, right? You had 10 years of data of bird births at Point Reyes Station. Chernobyl happens in April of 1986. Correct me if I screw this. 60% drop in bird births, right? He's affirming. And what was the explanation? There was only one explanation. The cloud from Chernobyl came to California within 10 days, came down in a rainstorm and killed 60% of the birds. And, you know, and this man is the only one who came out and had the courage to. So thank you very much for doing that. Did the radiation from Fukushima come here? You bet it did. I mean, our president got on national television about 4 or 5 days after and said, don't worry, the radiation's not going to come to the United States and it won't harm anybody. Total lies, both of them. No scientific data whatsoever for saying that the radiation wasn't going to come here, quite the opposite. No scientific radiation, no scientific data to say that it wouldn't harm people. Absolutely false. We know since 1956 that there is no safe dose of radiation. Why? Because a British doctor, Alice Stewart, I had the privilege of meeting with her. You don't mess with Alice Stewart. She was doing a general study, a broad-based study of the effects of why children in England were getting childhood leukemia. She had a laundry list of possible effects. One jumped out, X-ray of pregnant women. It was and she proved in 1956, even a single X-ray to a pregnant woman will cause a doubled childhood leukemia rate among the offspring. There is no safe dose of radiation because the embryo and the fetus, among others, are infinitely sensitive. You will never find a safe dose for an embryo or a fetus, let alone an algae or phytoplankton. So we know that the radiation from Fukushima came here. We know, and of course the government, the one thing the nuclear industry has been really, really good at is not studying health effects of radiation. And so, you know, immediately after Fukushima, the Food and Drug Administration stopped monitoring fish from the Pacific Ocean for radiation. The same thing happened in Pennsylvania. They had a tumor registry in Pennsylvania. They were tracking cancer. They dismantled that immediately after Three Mile Island. And then they say, well, there's no evidence that people were harmed at Three Mile Island. I went into central Pennsylvania after Three Mile Island. I guarantee you people were harmed. I've read the studies from Chernobyl. There's a one study, a compendium of 5,000 studies that shows over 1 million people have died from Chernobyl. What's the death toll going to be from Fukushima? Well, we've already got a really bad indicator. There is a Fukushima Medical University. It's a private institution. It does get federal money from the Japanese government. They are studying about 400,000 children in the Fukushima area. We are now at 40 times normal thyroid cancer rate among children. 40 times normal. 40 times normal thyroid abnormalities, and that will go up. We're almost to half of the children in the Fukushima area with thyroid abnormalities, cysts, growths, other thyroid problems. And I will tell you that the really bad news from Chernobyl, and I'm sure many of you have seen the pictures, is that there are areas in Belarus and Ukraine, downwind from Chernobyl, where 20% of the children are healthy. 80% of the children have been affected by, in these areas, particular areas, downwind from Chernobyl, have been affected by the radiation. It's that bad. So there could be other bad news. What do we got for time here? I got 12 minutes. Okay.
You have 15 minutes.
15, okay.
Oh, no.
That's all right. So at any rate, there's no compromising with this technology. There's absolutely no such thing. One of the reasons we said no nukes, it was an abolitionist statement. We wanted to make it clear that there's no, you know, we didn't say safer nukes or fewer nukes. We just said no. And because there's no safe thing, there's no safe nuke, and there's no economical nuke. There's no nuke that's not going to do huge ecological damage. And now, after all these years, we've shown we can win. And we have to win. We have no choice but to win. I mean, I have a grandson in LA. We're actually thinking of moving to LA. It's the only thing that could ever get me to move to LA is the grandson. And what more would I want in life than to be able to take my grandson to the beach? Nothing. But, you know, now we have to think twice about things like this. That's the, you know, I think of Masters of War by Bob Dylan, you know. You ain't worth the water that runs down my drain, you people who build these things. But to be fair, and we do need to be fair if we're going to win, it's the corporations. There's a virus that has infected human society. And it's the corporation, this insane financial device that has human rights but no human responsibilities, that is not held accountable. Nuclear power being the number one. And we all know that the nuclear industry is not accountable for more than $12.5 billion of damage they do. Tokyo Electric Power Company, which caused this disaster, still owns Fukushima. It's insane. They made $8 billion last year in profit. And Fukushima has become a profit center for Tokyo Electric Power because they're getting federal money to come in and clean it up. There's organized crime running the site, the Japanese mafia. Same thing would happen at Diablo Canyon. PG&E would never let it go. And they'd say, well, we'll clean it up. And they'll take the money to clean it up, and they have no liability. It's absolutely bonkers, basically. And so this is what we have to stop. And you know, I don't want to sound arrogant, but we've been winning. The question is, will we win fast enough? Will we get the remaining 100 reactors in the United States and the remaining 360 or so worldwide shut down fast enough to before we have the next Fukushima? And you know, there is a progression here. There was a meltdown at the Fermi nuclear plant in 1966. Thankfully, it didn't explode. We had a meltdown, which they denied, by the way. They denied that fuel melted at Three Mile Island. But then we found out, of course, it did. And they just said, oh, never mind. But there was no explosion. Then we had an explosion at Chernobyl. Everybody said, well, that's as bad as it gets. Now we've had four explosions at Fukushima. God forbid, it could get. We see what comes next. So that's our job. We have to prevent what comes next. We have to make sure there's not another meltdown. So here in California, Diablo Canyon is a little newer than some of the other reactors. It's not quite as economically challenged yet, but we have to go in there. I mentioned in Berkeley, there's a lovely little B&B, bed and breakfast in San Luis Obispo. It's the county jail. I was there for 3 nights. Food was lousy, and they make you wear these orange things. And it's just not my color. But, you know, we're going to have to go at Diablo Canyon. And there's only three reactors left on the West Coast, by the way. There's one up in Washington State, which is on the brink, and then these two at Diablo Canyon. It's going to be tough to force those that shut, but we have no choice. And so as Californians, we have a unique opportunity and a unique responsibility. And it can be done. There's absolutely no doubt about it. The industry is rolling backwards. And of course, it's because of renewable energy. So I'm going to put on my third T-shirt here. And this is in honor of your new marijuana laws and of the referendum that will pass in 2016, legalizing pot. I actually don't smoke pot, but I've always supported its legalization. This is George Washington, Ben Franklin, and Thomas Jefferson smoking pot, pot-smoking patriots here. We don't really know if they... I wrote a book saying George Washington, a satire, portraying George Washington as a gay pot smoker. It's not likely he was gay, but it's fun to write about. We don't know if he smoked pot, but it's possible. He definitely raised hemp. There's absolutely no doubt about that. He loved raising hemp, as did Tom Jefferson. Ben Franklin, his first paper mill processed hemp for paper. And of course, if there was any founding father that was likely to smoke pot, it would have been Ben Franklin, but that's another lecture. So back when we started fighting news first, you know, people said, well, what are you going to do for the power? Are you going to get rid of the power? How are you going to get the energy? And we said, solar, wind. You know, we had no idea what we were talking about, but it was there. And then we did have, in Amherst, Massachusetts in 1975, there was a fair, a Toward Tomorrow fair. And there was a guy there named William Hieronymus who was pushing 5 megawatt windmills. Everybody said he was crazy. And now we're building, GE is building 5 megawatt windmills. And then there was another guy, a really shrimpy guy with a mustache, named Amory Lovins. And Amory Lovins really knew what he was talking about. He still does. If you're looking for a source on renewable energy, rmi.org, RockyMountainInstitute.org. Amory is totally reliable and on the case. I'll never forget, he said that he started talking about hybrid cars back in the 70s. And I was like, oh, you're crazy. Invest with Amory. I should get a bumper sticker. So nonetheless, this technology that came out of nowhere, the first solar cell, first photovoltaic cell wasn't built until 1954. I actually held it in my hand. It goes around with the American Solar Energy Society. Anybody know where the second solar cell is? It's up in space on the Voyager. That's what it was made for. And that first solar cell has not stopped generating electricity. There's no theoretical limit to how long they will generate. They do decline, but they apparently don't die, which is quite amazing, actually. So photovoltaic cells, PV, will be on every home, every office building, every parking garage, every structure, every vehicle, every device. You name it, false teeth will have photovoltaic cells. I want to get my front tooth to be a PV unit. That would be really cool. So they will be a multi-trillion dollar industry. Now, there have been bumps, as you would expect. The Chinese decided to drop the market out. The bottom out of the market. They wanted to corner the photovoltaic industry. That's why Solyndra went out and a few of the other big ones. But the bottom line is that this stuff continues to plummet. They will not be able to corner the market. It's just too big. And they are now actually turning back some of their production in China to domestic consumption. And Claire was just in China and can tell us a little bit, hopefully, about the state of the environmental movement in China. And there is one. And she visited there, and we need to know about that because the Chinese are very schizophrenic right now. They're building or talking about building lots of nukes, and at the same time they're trying to corner the market in PV, and something's going to have to give. And they're very close to Fukushima. Well, we know also that this other very small country in Europe called Germany is making the total transition. This is the largest economy in Germany, the fourth largest in the world. After Fukushima, it's a complex story, but after Fukushima, they made the definitive decision to go away from nuclear and totally into renewables. And this, by the way, had to be a corporate decision. I mean, there was plenty of grassroots. There was a huge green movement.
all that stuff, plenty of political power behind doing this. But it wouldn't happen if Siemens and the other corporations said, okay, you know, we could probably make more money, finally, in renewables. So wind, PV, all that stuff is spreading totally around Germany, and even gave us one of the best punchlines from Fox News. I don't know how many of you saw this, but they were discussing on Fox the transition in Germany. One of their commentators said that it's easier for Germany to transition to solar because they have more sunlight in Germany than in the United States. That went viral, believe me. So at any rate, that's where the money is. I tell you right now that there are many thousands of people working in the renewable energy industry than there are in coal. And it's very comparable to gas and certainly to oil in this country. I mean, this is a major employer now. It was before, by the way, you know, before the apocalypse came, otherwise known as Ronald Reagan and George Duke Manchin, we had a huge solar industry in California. At least 10,000 people were working in renewables when Reagan came in, and then Duke Manchin. And so, you know, we've seen this before. This time we're not going to be turned back. The power is too great. And I got to tell you, one of our greatest allies, I have to wash my mouth out after I say it, is Wall Street. Wall Street has not backed nuclear for decades. They really, the big money does not believe in nuclear power, and they do believe in renewables. There are billions of dollars being invested in renewables. Now, we have our battles at the local levels. There is pushback. We're getting serious pushback right now from King Kong. I mean, we're getting all these you got to pay money to put solar panels on your roof. There's law in Ohio, if you put solar panels on your roof and disconnect from the grid, you still have to pay the utility bill. I mean, it's staggering, these guys who allegedly believe in a free market. So all this outrageous stuff is coming at us, but it's desperation. It's the dark before dawn. Because it's very, very clear that renewables are cheaper. Actually, the turning point came just around the time of Fukushima, independently of Fukushima. But in 2011, you started to read in Forbes and in Fortune and in Bloomberg and in all the even the Wall Street Journal, all the major financial sections, were when they were being honest and weren't, you know, not like the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal, the news section, they were saying, look, you know, we've reached the tipping point here. Solar is actually cheaper than fossil fuels now. And you know, coal is also finite, it's running out. I mean, I flew recently from Washington, D.C. to Columbus, Ohio, where I live in, and you look down in West Virginia, it's becoming desert. The mountaintop removal, it's apocalyptic, horrifying. But it means that they can't get coal any other way. And you know, they were there at the end of the rope with coal. They've been at the end of the oil rope for a while, and this fracking thing, that's something we're really going to have to fight. We're going to have to stop fracking. But for the time being, it is putting pressure on nukes. And that's not worth the price, but that's what's happening. And so I want to also say, and electric cars, very important to understand that electric cars, New Jersey and Ohio, the legislatures, which, you know, I don't go to downtown in Columbus anymore, the legislature. It's like being in Night of the Living Dead, you know, that movie. I think that there is a requirement, if you're going to be in the Ohio legislature, you have to have a lobotomy. So in Ohio and New Jersey, they're passing laws banning the sale of Tesla cars. Because they're saying that Tesla is refusing to open service stations.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Well, hey, electric cars don't need service stations. You don't have to change the oil on an electric car. You don't have to change the spark plugs. You don't have to deal with antifreeze. I mean, come on, guys. The point is these things are way more efficient. And what we've seen with renewables is they've come in ahead of schedule and under budget, generally. Most renewable stuff does do that, as opposed to nukes and the fossil stuff. 2 minutes, okay. So the good news is this, that we're really have crossed the line here. I want to talk, I promised you, and I'm going to say, I have to say this. We have shown George Will, America's number one blowhard, you know, pompous blowhard, right? He's the most pompous blowhard in America. He came out with a column yesterday that confirmed that Richard Nixon committed treason in 1968. He intervened in the Paris peace talks. and prevented the South Vietnamese from reaching a ceasefire with North Vietnam so that he could become elected president and Hubert Humphrey would be defeated. There's no doubt about it. And Kissinger, who was working for Lyndon Johnson, secretly told Nixon to do this and then joined Nixon and then got the Nobel Prize for making the peace in Vietnam that he prolonged the war for 4 years. Now that was a conspiracy theory until yesterday. Okay, so the other conspiracy theory is that we can have a total Solartopia, that we can have a green power Earth, and that George Washington was a gay prophet. So believe all that stuff. Thank you very much. Let's talk. Don't leave, please, without giving your email so that we can all get together and especially focus on shutting the ammo.
We have time for questions.
Oh, we have 10 minutes for Q&A. Please, yes.
Have you heard of any restorative technology that will either clean up the effects of nukes in the environment besides maybe some mushrooms, for example? But how about storage? Is there anything that can be done to store nuke waste?
It's actually a big issue with that. I'm glad you said that. The American reactors.
Would you repeat the question?
Yes. Is there any restorative technology to deal with nuclear waste? Well, of course, the first restorative technology is to stop producing it. Yeah. And that's always the first line of defense. But as opposed to the Europeans and even the Japanese, the American reactor owners are refusing to take the spent fuel rods out of the pools. This is insane. These spent fuel pools, you know, at all the reactor sites, where they put in the spent fuel rods, were only designed for about a fifth or less of the rods that are filling them all. The reactors have been operating since 1957. And the Americans refused to pull them out and put them in boxes. I mean, that's all, they have these dry casks. They're just boxes, basically, with ventilation. But even that is better than the pools. And we're at the point now, given the longevity of these reactors, that the pools are way more dangerous than the reactor cores themselves. What happened in Fukushima 4, Unit 4, you know, the geniuses that built these reactors and put the spent fuel rods, the pool is 100 feet in the air. And we think that the fuel rods at Fukushima 4 were exposed to air. It's a horrendous, that's, you know, a beyond a nightmare at this point in time. And so in terms of restoring places that have been irradiated, that's a whole, we got to shut the reactors first, and we maybe can deal with that. So, yes. Please.
I just wanted to point out that actually the Americans and many other countries have been using what's called high burn-up fuel for the last 17 years, which requires more time in the spent fuels pools, like 15 to 20 years.
Right.
And in the prior technology that they used with the fuel rods only took 5 years in the pools, and they still let them in. But now, it made them more money to use the high burn-up fuel rods, and they are twice as radioactive, twice as thermally hot, and because of that, they are disintegrating. And so it makes the whole nightmare problem of how to deal with the radioactive waste even more horrendous, because they don't have the technology to deal with these falling apart fuel rods that are causing problems in the fuel pools, and they don't certainly have the casks that are capable. I mean, it's just a mess.
Well, they have no incentive. There's no incentive for these guys to do right by the nuclear waste. Carter signed a bill, you know, an agreement in the late 70s that the feds would take responsibility for it. And these corporations, you know, by law, they're required to make as much money as they can. So they've no incentive to spend money on the waste side of the equation. I want to give you another victory. In Unit 3 at Fukushima, they did use some of this MOX fuel, mixed oxide fuel, which has plutonium in it. And NIRS and some of the other, Beyond Nuclear and the other groups fought, along with the Japanese, of course. And they minimized, there was far less MOX fuel in Unit 3 than there would have been otherwise. And if you look at the four videos of the four explosions, at Fukushima. The one at Unit 3 looks suspiciously like a fission explosion. The other three explosions were hydrogen. But the one in Unit 3 looks like it could have been fission, a bomb. And it, had there been more, and also we found plutonium pellets, an inch or more, a mile away from Fukushima. This is not a good sign. And so it's highly likely that had it not been for the opposition, there would have been more plutonium in the core at Unit 3, and that would have been, that could have been. And just to give you some scale, there are very credible estimates that the amount of cesium that's been released at Fukushima is 30 times greater than what was released at Hiroshima. So we're really talking an apocalyptic event here, and that's more the bad news. So somebody ask me a happy question, please. Yes.
So it appears that you've been an activist for almost as long as I've been alive, and I'm just wondering, you seem like you're in a good mood and you're productive, and I'm just wondering if you could give us some tips about longevity and activism and ways to stay connected and involved and upbeat.
You have to understand two things. First of all, you can win, and second of all, you have no choice. So, you know, I just happen to believe, as a historian, I think that the survival instinct is stronger than the profit motive. Mm-hmm. And bad as these corporations are in the long term, we are in control. You know, and it will be the peasants with the pitchforks and the torches marching up the hill, and we will prevail ultimately because we have to.
But what do you do personally that makes, I mean, were you just born optimistic?
I work out.
Yeah.
I lift weights, I ride a bike, I swim, I eat well, and you know, I think part of it's genetic also. But you know, you can be an optimist or you can be a pessimist, it's your choice.
What's the difference?
Basically. What's that?
What's the difference?
I don't know, actually.
An optimist, an optimist says, wow, this is great, this is all there is. And a pessimist says, this is all there is?
There you go. I've had a great life, so that, and well, I will admit also that I've been in the movement all these years, basically to meet really good looking women, so it's been very successful.
Yes. A follow-up question to that, which is a really excellent question, thank you so much, that's always my question, is what about the inner voice, what about the heart, when you're thinking about your choice about activism?
Well, the question, that really boils down to being committed to nonviolence.
Can you repeat?
What about the inner voice and what about the heart, right? So, you know, I got five kids. I got five grandkids. And I didn't always, but you know, I always had nieces and nephews. And like I say, winning that victory at that roller rink in 1962, I met Martin Luther King in 1966 for a nanosecond. I was in Mississippi and I walked into the back door of a church and walked around and you know what my first thought was? God, I'm taller than him. It didn't make sense to me, but I was, you know? So, you know, winning is good. I like to win. I grew up in Central Ohio. I played football, baseball, basketball, and tennis. Winning meant a lot. And, you know, we ultimately good triumphs over evil because of the survival instinct. And I believe in our survival instinct. I don't believe that we're destined to wipe ourselves out. There's too many Disney movies growing up to believe that. Yes?
Yes, I'd like to talk about Fiamma Canyon a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, we were trying to stop that when it was starting. And not very many young people seem to be aware of what's going on. If you look at the people around here, we believe you, but, you know, where are the young? How do we make that? Make that a cause, and
people,
young people will be able to support. I don't even know.
Well, you know what? The young people are out fighting fracking. There's a clear generational difference in the issues, and I actually embrace it. You know, we grew up with the nuclear issue, and we understand it, and I think we're timing it just about right. You know, the younger people. I've been to fracking rallies. The average age is in the 20s, and that's their issue. That doesn't mean we can't fight fracking or they won't fight nukes. But and the average age of the nuclear things is definitely older. But that's okay, because the nukes themselves are older too. And you know, and so you know, our duty is to outlive them. And that's the best revenge. Whose line was that? Somebody had a line. It was that outliving your enemy is the best revenge. So that's what we got to do. So eat well, you know, lots of sex, lots of exercise, and always, always have a sense of humor. That's what you're really going to do.
If you're not familiar with the Thrive movement, Thrive is a film that was made that looks at global domination of education and healthcare and food and environment and by a handful of very wealthy people on the planet. It talks about solutions. It's pretty vital to this conversation. Thrive.
Right. Yeah. I mean, look. Corporate concentration of wealth is the number one issue, and unaccountability of corporations. That's the virus from which we suffer. I'm just in the process of writing a U.S. history book. It works on a theory of cycles, and it ends in a spiral, and that's what's happening. And we are now a global society. I know it's become a cliche, but in 1992, we changed generational control. Clinton won. We've had three pot-smoking presidents in a row: Clinton, Bush, and Obama. It's the first time, actually, since the 1800s, that we've had three consecutive re-elected presidents. And there's definitely a shift, a paradigm shift. 20 cents, two dimes. In the 1990s, never underestimate the importance of the internet. The internet has really linked us all in a certain way, and that's very much a part of the Solartopian green power revolution. It also, I believe, not to go too far afield, but I believe it's going to open up the cure for cancer also. Mm-hmm. There is no single cure for cancer. What the cure for cancer will be, and again, I had a tumor in my lung, but it's not cancer. I said that wrong. It's not cancer, but I have a tumor in my lung. And I did about a year of research on it. And I'm convinced that the way cancer will be dealt with, ultimately, is that all of us will have our human genome mapped, as did Steve Jobs. But he didn't follow the regimen that he had to do. And there will be a combination of natural and technological cures. There will be a role for chemo, there will be a role for diet, and all these other things that are out there. And it'll all be based on an individual reading of the human genome. That's the first time I've ever said that. But it's the result of my own particular slam with cancer. And I think that the same thing is happening with energy. And this is why the corporations are terrified, and this is why this is such an incredibly important transition with renewables. It's not just a turnover of technologies. It's also a turnover of control. And why are we getting such a pushback on renewables? I mean, it should be mom and apple pie, solar energy, wind, all this stuff. The reason is that it marks the death knell of the power of the corporations over energy. Because that's the fight now in Germany, is that they're big centralized windmills, what they call distributed generation, which is really just community and individual control, has accelerated way faster than they thought it would. And people are just opting to get the panels on their house, get the LEDs in the house, get it totally efficient, and take down the grid. And so, the smart grid stuff is bullshit. Yeah. It's not where we want to go. And there's no smart grid. The grid has to be done away with. And so, just like fighting cancer, which I think will be individualized, every individual will get a single unique cancer treatment. And that same thing is happening with our energy supply. And that's the death of the corporate. That's no more PG&E. No more Southern California. Everybody, and that's why they're fighting so hard. That's why, the technological stuff is more or less been solved. I mean, the price needs to continue to come down. But, this is the political battle we're fighting. It's a battle for democratic control at the grassroots, and that's what we ultimately need to win. Yes?
We got one more question there. We're going to work
on that. I so love your work for voting rights and democracy, and so glad you mentioned the bigger picture about corporations. I want to urge everybody to work for Prop 49. It's really important that pass in California for a constitutional amendment to end corporate personhood and money as speech. We need to do more than overturn Citizens United, because the corporations had already taken control before 2010. So Prop 49 will send the message that the Assembly Joint Resolution 1, which calls for just overturning Citizens United, but that's not enough. We got to do more than that, and we can do it. But I have a history question for you,
okay.
Which is, well, I heard that, was it Herbert Hoover was our big ally somehow?
In renewables.
Yeah, I want to know about that.
I hadn't heard that much about it. He was a Quaker, weirdly enough, Herbert Hoover. Huh. You know, our two Quaker presidents have been.
Nixon
and Hoover. Yeah. God forbid Nixon really should be have been a Quaker. But I will take, since you made a question about history, the guy who made the single biggest impact on energy efficiency and fighting global warming was actually Ben Franklin. Because Ben Franklin invented the Franklin stove. Until that time, everybody burned wood in the fireplaces. You can't get a more inefficient, cancer-causing, global warming culprit than the open fireplace. And I'll finish with this. You know, I want to really hand it to Elon Musk for giving away his patents. That's a big deal. And there was a precedent. Ben Franklin invented the lightning rod. And, it works, actually. And when it came time to patent it, he said something you'll never hear from the Koch brothers. He said, you know what, I got enough money. I'm just going to give it away. So thank you so much, everybody.
Don't you know we're gonna have a Solartopia, all alone.